first of all, I will not present the results because we just started the project a year ago and we have still 2 years to develop. Oh yeah, the presentation is about similarity analysis of African red slipware with modern 3D and 2D processing techniques. What is the project about? It's about African red slipware. We want to 3D document the multi-perspective analysis of the central object genus of late antiquity, like Manta told before. Aim of the project is the 3D digitization and to set up an ontology, not for all African red slipware, of course, because we want to get innovative and sustainable exploitation for research, and we want to set new documentation standards. And the funding is by the Federal Ministry of Education and Research in Germany, and we are cooperating with the Roman German Central Museum. And yeah, the object we want to analyze is the African red slipware. You can see here an example. The characteristic of African red slipware is the relief decoration. I hope you can see it. Here attached on this bowl are applications, and most of the applications of the African red slipware show biblical motifs, and we want to analyze these applications. So to happily, the Roman German Central Museum is owning about 336 of these African red slipware. Most of them, like you can see here, are fragments of bowls, but there are still some undestroyed bowls, like you can see here. And also we have got models. I'm not sure if it's the right English word. Models are the negative forms from which you can build the applications, which will then be attached in the later process of processing the African red slipware to be attached on the bowls. And yet up till now there are I'm nearly at the end of my presentation. Up till now there are only 2D information about African red slipware, and only experts are reachable to this information. Our goal is to create for the future a unique digital reference catalog, which includes, for example, these components. We want to compare if applications are potentially identical. We want to maybe connect fragments and can show if there have been one bowl in the past, and we want to reach metadata for every digitized object. And the results of these components we want to show in a web viewer, which will be based on ontological identification and classification of the image content of the appliques and the facet shapes. To realize the project, we have five working packages. First, the data acquisition and processing of the objects, then the development of an analysis tool, and the development of an ontology, and the last working packages are the development of linked data tools. My colleague Florian Terry is sitting in the last row, showed it on session 12, I think, 14, on Wednesday. And of course we need the archaeological interpretation, which also comes from the Roman German Central Museum. And I will focus in this presentation about, or I will just tell something about the first two packages, the data acquisition and processing, and the development of, or the ideas, the first ideas of the development of the analysis tool. Okay. For the data acquisition, we are using for the scanning part a structured light scanner or a fringe projecting scanner. It means it's the same, to achieve 3D models of every object. Additionally, we want to record the surface texture of every object. This is happening by using photogrammetric techniques with professional illumination and color calibration, because our aim is to get geometrically correct projection of the texture onto the corresponding 3D data. Therefore, we use a GOM ARTOS triple scan structured light scanner, and for the photogrammetry, we are using a Systim camera Nikon D800. And here you can see the general procedure for the data acquisition. We have to acquire each object from both sides, because it's not possible to do the scanning from the whole object in one scan process. So we are acquiring first the top side of the object, and here it is very important because we want to combine the texture and the scanning part, that we have to acquire the scanning and the photo in one process. Means we have these reference point frames. We have two different reference point frames. One frame is for the top side and one is for the bottom side. They both have uncoded reference points in different arrangements to each other. And during the acquisition of the top side, for example, the object is lying with the top side on the reference point frame 1, and when we are first doing the scanning part and directly the acquiring of the photos is following, we are not allowed to move the object on the reference point frame, because we want to be sure that the pictures and the 3D model of the object are in the same coordinate system. So this is the most important part, that it is really not allowed to move the object during the acquisition. And we have to do it for the bottom part too. So after the acquisition, we have four data sets, two scanning sets, bottom and top side, and for the bottom and top side, each photo data set. And then the main processing steps are shortly described here. We have to align the two scanning parts to each other. Here we are not using the reference points which are on the frames. We are just using, like you can see here, the overlapping areas which are seen in both scannings. When we have this, we can do a common polygonization of the two scans together, so that we have a mesh instead of point clouds. And a very important step too is that we, during the alignment of the scans, we align the points of the reference point frames to each other too. So now the uncoded points of the reference point frames are in the same coordinate system. That's very important, because we need the reference points for the texturing later. Okay, now when we have a 3D model, we can export it, because we will use it later for the texturing, and can go to the photos. We have to align the photo chunks from the top side and from the bottom side to each other, that we have the alignment of the picture of the pictures. This is happening in Agisoft. I think most of you will know it. And it's using the technique structure for motion, just for the understanding. And when the alignment of the photos is done, we can import the reference point file from the scanning part and set the reference point in the picture. So now we have got the pictures and the 3D model in the same coordinate system. If we have this point, we can import the 3D model, which we have done before, and in Agisoft can match the texture of the pictures to the 3D model by generating masks. I will not explain it extra. And so as a result, we have a textured 3D model of each object. And this we want to present in a 3D viewer. The plan at the moment is that we will use 3D Hop as basis, because here you can use multi-resolution models which enable fast loading times and good performance. In fact, we are doing different stuff here where we need sometimes bigger data. And we are using three tools from 3D Hop at the moment, the light source change, the measurement feature, and the texture hiding, because our archaeologist is using the web viewer for the interpretation, so she can watch or look at the 3D data and play with shading, for example, to see more details on the object. And very shortly, as I announced before, we want to build an ontology where we want to save the annotations by the archaeologists. For example, if Luise, she's our archaeologist, it's a very strange word, Luise has to select an applique like here and has to do her annotation and interpretation. In this example, it means she is looking at this part, at this applique, and she does her observation. And here she sees a lion, it's dead, nearly dead, and the lion is here, and she sees a very muscular, bearded, naked male strangulating a lion. Due to these observations, her interpretation is, hey, this must be Hercules choking the Nemean lion, because of the argumentation, choking a lion is one of the 12 deeds of Hercules. And this annotation and interpretation will then be stored in our ontology. And here a quick overview of the ontology. It will combine the most important part of the project, the professional view, means the archaeological interpretation, the processing part, the settlement parameters, etc. And the geometry means the size, form, curvature, etc. of the object. So the ontology allows content to be structured, linked, and made mutually usable and queryable. And so I will go to the part we are now working on, developing. We want to do the analysis of similarities of the applications. Goal is to compare if two appliques are nearly identical, because we want maybe to solve the question, have two objects been manufactured in the same factory because of their similarity. The problem here is that the appliques are deformed differently depending on the object they are attached. Like you can see here, the application is formed another way than it would be when it would be attached on this object. So first we have to transform all appliques to an undeformed initial state, means we have to flatten it. Therefore, at the moment, the general approach is following. We have to select the applique, like you can see here, and have to clip it from the entire object, because we just want to analyze the application and not the whole object. When we have done this, we want to determine a base geometry of the object for this application. Okay, it means we determine a cylinder, and with the cylinder we can map the object surface of the application to the base geometry. So we flatten it, and we have to do it with all the applications we want to compare. And if we are lucky, and here we are lucky, the applications are identical. So this is the state of the project at the moment, and just as example how we think or how we want to do the analysis. First, we wanted to use an area-based approach, but this is not feasible due to imperfect transformation and mapping. It's not working at the moment. So now we are working on a key-based approach, means we want to detect key points in both appliques. We have to find then corresponding key points. From this corresponding key points, we can compute transformation parameters, and with these transformation parameters, we hopefully are able to map two appliques onto each other and compute similarity. And optionally, when this is working, we want to use again the area-based approach because maybe it's easier to do it when the key point based approach is working. And this is the state of the project at the moment, and yeah, we have at least 2 more years to develop the analysis tool and the rest of the project. So thank you for your attention.